Yeah? The next artist we're going to see is someone who's been here before, Alasdair Foster. I first met him in 1995 in Mexico, actually in Oaxaca. And we were there late at night on top of, was it an Inca temple? Yeah, up an Inca temple on a moonlit night, looking down at the city of Oaxaca from there. And then we gathered in the house of Francesco Toledo. And looking at the walls, you notice there's an original Cartier-Bresso, there's a Salgado, there's Kudelka, and things like that all around. And as we walked through, there's a guy in sort of what looked like a kurta, khandar kurta and all that, sort of sitting on the dust, talking to someone else, and then someone whispers to me, that's Francesco Toledo. But this guy had transformed that city of Oaxaca and really revolutionized the artistic scene over there. And that's where we first met and had many conversations since. Alasdair also was very helpful in getting Trent Park's exhibition, Minutes to Midnight, to Bangladesh, shortly after Trent was had joined Magnum. We're very happy to have Alasdair back with us, but we also have an extra treat. Her Excellency Julia Niblett, the Australian High Commissioner, has very kindly agreed to do the welcome address. Julia.
Thank you so much, Shahidul. So good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I have to say, I've just been transported from Mexico back to Dhaka. It's an honour and a great privilege for me to attend the prestigious Chobi Mela Festival, the greatest photography event in Asia. This year's festival gives us a wonderful catalogue of a world in transition, ranging from Indian independence, Chechen resistance, and Bangladesh today. It presents a vast and, from what I've seen, a sometimes poignant history of the interplay between East and West and between this country, Bangladesh, and the region in which it's situated. It's indeed an epic of how people see themselves and how others see them. The focus of the festival on the individual experience when we encounter photography powerfully reinforces the value we place on each human life. This is one of the wonderful things of the exhibition. Speaking of the theme, a world in transition, I have to observe that the proliferation of smartphones with cameras has meant quite a resurgence in photography as a medium to share individual stories, and it even allows many of us to produce art as amateurs. I just want to leave that thought with you because I want to mention that today I'm very proud to introduce you to Mr. Alasdair Foster, who will discuss this topic in depth. And while some would argue that amateurism is a threat to full-time artists, Alasdair, in fact, will argue that it is healthier for both the country. So just moving on from Shahidul's reminiscing about first meeting Alasdair, can I just tell you that he has 20 years' experience heading national arts institutions and over 35 years of working in the public cultural sector. Alasdair was the founding director of Fotofais Festival, Europe's largest photo event of the 90s. He was doing that from 1991 to 1997. He was the director of the Australian Centre for Photography for 13 years, from 1998 to 2011. That's quite a long gig in that role. He recently completed his doctoral research at Monash University in Melbourne, and he's an associate member of the Centre for Visual Anthropology at the Australian National University in Canberra, our capital. He's now a Sydney-based writer and an award-winning curator. He initiates intercultural art and photography projects globally. So it's an absolute treat to have him come to Bangladesh to participate in Chobi Mela 9. But before we welcome Alasdair on stage, I'd very much like to congratulate Festival Director Shilpakala South Asian Media Institute for creating another fabulous world-class event. I'd like you all now to join me in welcoming Alasdair Foster.
Thank you, High Commissioner. Good afternoon, everyone. It's a great pleasure to be here with Alam and his team for the Commonwealth Government of Australia, who've supported my visit through the Australia Awards programme. The ideas I'm about to explore with you arise from an extensive 10-year research into the formation of arts policy and the importance of participatory culture as a public good. That research is also based on almost 40 years working in the public arts. My research area is not limited to photography or the visual arts, but encompasses all art forms. That research focused initially on the situation in the English-speaking West, and many of my specific examples tend to arise from that context. However, the broader conclusions address what I believe are more fundamental community needs. So I hope you will find this interesting both as a window onto the Anglophone arts issues of the moment and an insight into the wider human relationships we have to art. There's a couple of definitions I might just give you, which are the beginning, just to avoid misunderstanding. I'm going to talk about pro-ams, professional amateurs. In the meaning I'm applying here, a pro-am is someone who wishes to pursue an activity at a professional level, but does not seek to earn their living from it. The other term which it's important to understand is the word hacker. I'd emphasize that within internet technology, a hacker is not a criminal. The criminals who gain illegal access to other people's information are crackers. Hackers are internet pro-ams. I'll discuss this in more detail later, but it's important to bear those definitions in mind. You'll also see from the slides that I'm showing the languages bilingual English and Spanish. This is because I've recently given this lecture a number of times in Latin America. I hope the Spanish text won't prove to be too much of a distraction. And so, to the matter of creating shared culture. On Friday, the 2nd of August 2013, the world's largest arts festival opened in Edinburgh with a speech by the playwright Mark Ravenhill. He did not pull his punches. The arts in Britain had lost their way, and it seemed quite possible that public funding might very soon come to an end. "We need to have a plan B," he said, and I quote, "What if the public funding of the arts was a passing moment in British life? After all, it didn't begin until the 1940s, had its heyday in the 1960s and 1970s, and has been eroding and shrinking since the 1980s. Historically, that is a very short period of time. Business as usual would be the arts operating entirely within the marketplace with patrons and sponsors. Can you in any way see yourself making your work and speaking to an audience in that context? Or is that so abhorrent that you will enter into a massive fight for public investment in the arts over the next few years? And if you're going to enter into that fight, what are you really saying art is for to your community?" In Ravenhill's view, the arts had been colluding with a corrupt system in collapse. Artists had tried to be the best friends of the super rich and the most disadvantaged at the same time, and the public were beginning to smell a rat. He saw a certain clarity in the harshness of austerity. It established, as he put it, a government we can properly hate. It was a chance to throw off the seductive but debilitating rhetoric of New Labour's, quote, scientific management techniques, and to ask what art is for and where an artist's constituency can be found. Ravenhill's comments were not the only point of controversy as the Edinburgh Festival Fringe opened. An article written a year before by the comedian Stuart Lee remained a hot topic. In his opinion piece in the Guardian newspaper, Lee had argued that the strength of the fringe as an open access forum for artistic experimentation and risk-taking was being undermined by the exploitive commercialization of the four largest presenters. These multi-platform venues had seceded from the fringe 4 years earlier to rebrand as a separate, co-temporal Edinburgh Comedy Festival. While each of the big four had a reputation for comedy, their programmes encompassed a much wider range of genres, making the new festival's name both confusing and misleading. What was clear was that these highly commercial, heavily sponsored venues were, through their media schmoozing machinery, beginning to eclipse the 1,000 or more performances taking place on the fringe each day. The Edinburgh Festival Fringe is a completely open event. There's no content filtering. If you can find a venue, stage a production, and afford the modest registration fee, you can be in the programme. That's all that's required. For many years, this has permitted a remarkable array of the good, the bad, and the downright bizarre in an environment in which audiences welcomed risk takers and sought out experiences that would have had no commercially viable future. At its heart, the fringe was pro-am and amateur. In Lee's view, it had been built up collectively over 6 decades by the work of many hands, mostly unwaged, and if it belonged to anyone, it belonged to the public and performers who had floated it with their own funds for 61 years. The fringe, he argued, was threatened by an oligarchy that was dragging it into the deregulated free market phase of late capitalism. It was not that the performers in the big four venues were making a fortune. Lee asserted that many would agree to shed upwards of £10,000, that's about $12,500 US, just to be there, because those venues, with their lavish marketing machinery, were seen as a potential route to a television contract. The festival was becoming a trade fair, and the ones making the money were the middlemen and women, the new cultural intermediaries in Pierre Bourdieu's description. In an insidious process of commercialized gentrification, those who had built the festival and given it its distinctive character, one that over the years had been copied around the world, were being priced out of the game. As Lee said, it can cost so much to perform at the Edinburgh Festival Fringe now, and the very people being deterred by these costs are just the sort of independent minds that we used to value as a society. The same people now demonstrably priced out of further education. It's another example of the erosion of access, the reversal of social mobility, the entrenchment of privilege, and the gradual silencing of diverse voices. Within the microcosm of debate around the current situation and possible future of Edinburgh Festival Fringe lie some of the key questions facing the larger community with regard to our cultural life. A cultural life that is not merely a decorative optional extra. It is the means by which we come to better understand ourselves and seek to better understand others. The foundation on which we build identity and recognize difference, and a field of radical and adventurous thinking. Our culture is a public good. In talking about the public good, I'm going to talk about creating shared culture. Culture is a notoriously fuzzy and fluid concept. So first up, what do I mean by culture? In this discussion, the term culture is used broadly to describe the way in which creativity and imagination build a sense of personal and collective identity, develop narratives for comprehending the world, and engendering well-being. It is neither limited to the fine arts nor to the notion of rigid ethnic mores, though it may be partially shaped by these factors. It is certainly not bound by any narrow art world group and has little in common with the market for luxury artifacts. It's also important to understand that cultures are not nations or nationally defined. Indeed, the arts are specific activities and modes of production, and culture, as that broader description of the human environment within which those activities and artifacts exist and find their meaning, a very much older phenomena than the nation state. I'm just going to have a quick drink. The concept of the nation state is a modern one that goes back just a few hundred years. The idea that a nation has hard fixed borders arose not least from the increasing ability of cartographers to accurately represent territory as plan, but also from the relatively recent attempts to fuse notions of political geography with those of culture and ethnicity, leading to a praxis that assumes and indeed expects large-scale mutual identification of those within the border and difference from those outside it. More recently still, globalization has created a perception that somehow borders are dissolving, but it is only a partial dissolution. As it first came to be understood, globalization is a function of the internationalizing of markets, such that multinational corporations formed, in time coming to constitute a supra-governmental stratum of non-elected power and control. This is driven by extreme forms of resource mobility that challenge the meaning of the nation-state while exploiting cheap labor markets, high-earning retail markets, and havens of low taxation. Meanwhile, the resulting magnification of economic asymmetry sees a hardening of the rhetoric of borders as the rich seek to exclude the poor from sharing in any of those benefits. In such a view of globalization, borders become semi-permeable membranes which permit the osmosis of cheap goods and commodities and the free movement of wealthy individuals, but not the poor seeking the mobility to escape the poverty that maintains the low cost of production. But there are other forms of human grouping, much older than the nation state, forms that are by their very nature truly borderless and which find their strength in that very borderlessness. These are our communities in all their great variety, for communities are not defined by their edges but by their center, their gravitational core, their heart. They are formed by connection, not exclusion. By community, I mean a wide range of types and scales of human sharing and connectedness, from the extended family, friendship groups, and neighborhoods, through professional and special interest networks, to larger concepts of the local, national, and global community. In other words, community describes not a certain type or scale of group or its importance, but the gathering of people around. Community is then both a form of and expression of human interconnection. It is fractal in nature, operating in self-similar ways across a wide range of scales. I should note here that there is an unfortunate tendency in the Anglophone world to use the word community as an adjective, as a synonym for unfortunate, untalented, and uninformed. At best, community arts are seen as wholly instrumental, as serving as a societal palliative, a form of therapy whose products have little value save the generation of a certain cozy sentiment. As a result, community art is segregated from real art. For example, in the Australia Council for the Arts, community arts and cultural development is disability, young people, cultural diversity, emerging communities, Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people, and remote communities. There's nothing wrong with those potential clients and project areas, but why should they not be considered within the main art form departments, and what, if anything, do they have in common, except that they are marginalized by the hegemonic art world? But are we and they not all citizens? And if so, what does it mean to be a citizen anyway? While the idea of the citizen can be traced back at least as far as ancient Greece and later Rome, in the sense we use the term today, it's a very recent phenomenon. In this modern sense, a citizen is an adult member of the nation state. The citizenry and the populace are one and the same. The idea arose in the 19th century, but was not realised, in as far as a representational democracy can realise those aspirations, until the 20th century. I would argue that, in the Anglophone West, much of that status has been eroded since the Second World War. That mid-20th century moment saw, aside from war, an economic situation arise in which, more or less for the first time in history, production exceeded demand. An economy that had been driven by scarcity quickly found it needed to adjust to artificially stimulate markets that did not naturally exist. In the ensuing decades, citizens were steadily and stealthily reformed into consumers. And there's a significant difference between the two. Citizens have agency, especially when they act with others. Consumers are atomized and isolated, and their control is limited to what they choose to buy. This isolation is important because it's the job of advertising to create an unquenchable sense of inadequacy in the individual, so that they are motivated to buy the things that advertising promises will help to assuage that anxiety while never providing a final release. The world of art has seen a similar transformation as mass mediation has created a demand for a border to be erected and policed that separates a small number of creative producers from a large number of passive consumers. Before the 20th century, and the advent of mass media, the arts were primarily participatory, and the most common art experiences involved the individuals as active contributor. Bill Ivey, a former head of the US National Endowment for the Arts, and Stephen Tepper, a cultural policy academic, have described the increasingly centralized notions of excellence in the 20th century US culture, whereby recording and broadcasting technologies allowed previously fleeting art and entertainment to be captured and thereby produced and distributed on a mass scale. They contrast this with what has been lost in the process, and I quote, "Local and vernacular art and entertainment were eclipsed by a culture that was increasingly defined by the tastes of a national elite at Columbia Records or Universal Studios or non-profit arts organizations. Meanwhile, the amateurs at home were overshadowed by a new class of creative professionals, and audiences were increasingly socialized to be passive consumers, awaiting their favorite radio broadcasts or sitting in darkened theaters and concert halls, applauding on cue." This tendency was seen as a considerable danger in the period between the First and Second World Wars. In the UK, the government actively strove to encourage citizens not simply to consume art, but to be part of its making. When, in the 1930s, shrinking disposable income meant that people could no longer afford to join the choirs, brass bands, and theatre groups that had flourished in the 1920s, the British government asked the newly formed Carnegie UK Trust to create a fund for the arts. The specific requirement was that this should fund amateur art and not professionals. It was the amateur groups that employed the professionals as and when they were required, commissioning Vaughan Williams to write for their choir or hiring a professional conductor or strengthening a section of the choir by bringing in professional singers. They operated like a Presbyterian church, where it is the congregation and not the church authorities that hire the minister. This focus was maintained when, at the outbreak of the Second World War, the British government formed a partnership with another charitable foundation, the Pilgrim Trust, created by the American philanthropist Edward Harkness, to fund the making and touring of art in order to maintain wartime morale. At the end of the war, these temporary measures were consolidated and made more permanent in the establishing of the Arts Council of Great Britain. However, under its first chairman, the economist John Maynard Keynes, the emphasis suddenly and markedly shifted to a focus on professional art and a rejection of the amateur. For much of the second half of the 20th century, the funded arts have promoted a firm division between a small sector of professional producers and a broad market of passive consumers. Consumers whose tastes must be shaped to align with the prevailing art elite, rather than finding expression in active dialogue with and through the arts. As such, the arts have fallen into synchrony with the wider commercial world, in which markets are maintained by engendering a sense of inadequacy in the individual, rather than through the encouragement of and investment in each individual as a member of a larger community and a potential participant in the ongoing process of creating a shared and living culture. More recently, network communication has opened up lines of human connection which are at once global and yet accessible to the individual of modest means. Where the mass media of the later 19th and the majority of the 20th centuries was controlled by a small elite, the internet has, so far, remained relatively free. Certainly, large corporations have arisen with dizzying speed to provide some of the key tools operated by users of the internet. But it is the internet's very design, or indeed lack of design, that ensures it provides many ways around a barrier, and those who would try to lay territorial borders within the realm of network communication have so far been thwarted. The foundations on which the internet sits is a creation of many people working without pay or attribution, without a leader, and without a plan. They are hackers, the pro-ams of the communications world. And it is their very variety that is, so far, helping to maintain the relative freedom of the internet. And it is their lack of interest in celebrity or monetary reward that allows them to remain free of corporate control. The internet has certainly facilitated a significant shift in the balance of who can speak to whom, but I do not think it has caused that motivation in individuals. Rather, I would argue that it has provided a means by which a natural end finds expression, where once it was denied by the operation of technologies, how they were controlled, and by whom. It's worth remembering that when John Logie Baird invented television, he imagined it as a two-way technology. It was government and business that took control of the invention to ensure that it became a tool of broadcast rather than conversation. While the internet is less than three decades old, it has completely changed the way we communicate as individuals and as groups. Today, over 3.5 billion people are now connected to the internet, almost half the world's population. In just 1 minute, more than 150 million emails are sent, 2.5 million Google searches are made, around 200,000 photographs are uploaded to Facebook, and more than 3.5 million video clips are watched on YouTube. That's every minute. And it's all practically free. So, what do we do with that incredible resource? Well, one thing we do is make lolcats. I'm sure you've seen them, funny cat pictures with witty captions. Amusing, but is this the best we can achieve? Internet critic Andrew Keane sees this as exactly the kind of rot that set in with the introduction of the internet and, more precisely, Web 2.0. Adopting a distinctly institutional view, he is horrified by what he perceives as a breakdown of quality that comes from letting just anyone go public with just about anything they want to. He believes it's killing culture since most of it's put up for free, killing our economy by undermining the ability to monetize product. Others, such as Jaron Lanier, suggest that such technologies are reshaping human behavior and the human mind in ways that ultimately are detrimental. And then there's now the widespread view that with everybody glued to their mobile device. Breaking this down, I'd argue first that technologies are what we make of them. A pencil is a piece of technology. With it, I can solve a mathematical equation, write a poem, or design a house. If so moved, I could use it to write hate mail or poke out an eye. Those decisions are made by me, not the pencil. And not all technological innovations are successful. In the end, people decide if they're going to buy into an idea or not. The innovative snowstorm mask, proposed by a Quebecois inventor in 1930, 1989 could have radically changed the look of Montreal streets pre-Christmas, but it didn't catch on. Then again, there are other cases where an innovation may be creative with no clear understanding of how it might be used. When SMS was added to mobile phones in 1993, it was seen as a peripheral addition that might be useful in case of emergency or to allow companies to remind customers to pay their bills. But in the hands of users, it became huge. 25 years on, SMS is a major slice of the mobile telephony cake, with some 6.7 trillion messages sent each year. And then there are all those hopeful individuals sitting alone in their bedroom or garage, singing to their computer and posting the results on YouTube. What of them? Andrew Keane pitches them as poor fools. Are they lost, like the proverbial needles in a gargantuan haystack of the internet? Well, in the case of the singers you see here, the answer is no. They may be scattered around the globe, performing at different times, but these people are essentially singing together. They are members of a virtual choir initiated by the composer Eric Whittaker. It was an idea that came to him when a young girl named Britlin Losey sent him a video she'd made singing one of his compositions. Bringing the many individual videos together into a single work, shaped with a little virtual reality magic, this is what results. That was an extract from Sleep, involving 2,000 singers from 58 countries. The virtual choir's most recent project, Fly to Paradise, is a spectacular fusion of polyphony and manga. It was funded by $100,000 raised through the crowdfunding platform Kickstarter and involved 8,409 videos and 5,905 singers, a number singing more than one part, from 101 countries. What the virtual choir demonstrates is that individuals can connect without geographic proximity or even direct contact, but through the shared experience of participation. To participate is the best way to grow, because we learn most through doing, and we grow through learning. To be an active participant is to feel the upward pull of wanting to do more and do better. The difference between the internet and broadcast forms such as radio and television is that they offer the opportunity to be an active participant. Watching TV, where our involvement is limited to switching channels, there's no such drive to develop, but rather an enveloping inertia to passively accept whatever is being delivered. So, returning to the criticism of lolcats and their ilk, I would, to paraphrase Clay Shirky, put it this way. The difference is not between lolcats and the virtual choir. The difference is between doing something and doing nothing. And now, many more people are choosing to do something in the arts, no longer content to be passive spectators. The first decade of the 21st century has seen a marked rise in the number of people engaging in the visual and other arts at pro-am level. That is, with a professional level of skill, but not as paid work and not simply as a hobby. The young Finnish philosopher Pekka Himanen explored the shift in values held by the burgeoning and transnational community of online open source developers, who he calls hackers. It's important to note here, as I did before, that Himanen is using the term hacker as it refers to the subculture focused on modifying and improving software in a largely playful pursuit of excellence. They should not be confused with those who gain criminal access to other people's computers by exploiting software weaknesses. While they may be known popularly as hackers, within Himanen's use of language, such individuals are called crackers. In his book, The Hacker Ethic, he compares this with the Protestant ethic, which he sees as similarly founded on a network model, though differently motivated. The Protestant ethic famously divided activity into work and leisure, valorizing the former and mistrusting the latter as weak and self-indulgent, if not downright sinful. The elect, those predestined to go to heaven, might be recognized by their hard work and frugal lifestyle and by its fruits, material wealth and social standing. As such, it was the inverse of the leisure class described by Thorsten Veblen, where social status was measured by how little practical work an individual was required to undertake, the life of leisure being beautiful and ennobling in all civilized men's eyes, to quote Veblen. Contrasting these two extremes, Himanen describes a third value system which, in his view, is adopted by hackers, and I quote, "Hackers do not feel that leisure time is automatically any more meaningful than work time. The desirability of both depends on how they are realized. From the point of view of a meaningful life, the entire work-leisure duality must be abandoned. Meaning cannot be found in work or leisure, but has to arise out of the nature of the activity itself, out of passion, social value, and creativity." Himanen compares the Protestant and hacker ethics in detail. While the motivation driving the Protestant ethic is money born of hard work, for the hacker it is passion found in freedom. The Protestant ethic values optimality, efficiency, and the greatest benefit for the least cost. The hacker, on the other hand, measures value in terms of social worth. The Protestant ethic seeks impact while maintaining stability. The hacker pursues creativity that is open, freely, and freely shared. It does not seek or require a price tag to find its sense of worth. Himanen points to another difference in how value is estimated, that the relative importance of a node does not stem from its specific features, but from its ability to contribute valuable information to the network. That is, value does not inhere within the individual or their works per se, but in the relationship between the individual and the works with others in the wider network. If this analysis of the hacker ethic is correct, it heralds in that field at least, a very marked change in economic motivation. Not only that, but the emphasis on creativity seems to be more for its own sake than, say, the fiscal or instrumental benefits associated with Richard Florida's rising creative class or UK New Labour's creative industries. Since software development is a key component of both, it's important here to differentiate between hackers and commercial software developers. For the hacker, it's not the ethic of a particular kind of work, but of a particular kind of relationship to that work. In my view, it represents one significant aspect of a larger pro-am phenomenon, with its strong motivation to do something well and creatively without the aim of making money from it. This is not limited to the virtual world of the internet. The rise of a maker culture is a parallel real-world manifestation. Maker culture emphasizes making and adapting in a learning through doing approach that builds on informal peer-to-peer networking, motivated by self-expression and self-fulfillment rather than monetization of what is made. The availability of relatively cost-free communications networks has certainly assisted the maker movement to share ideas and strengthen its position, but it is a means and neither a cause nor an end in itself. The clearest measure of the recent rise in PROEM activity can be found in Australia, where, due to a prescient approach to data collection, whether by accident or design, the Australian Bureau of Statistics has been collecting data that captured measures of PROEM activity even before the term had been coined or the phenomenon become widespread. This allows for some of the only available longitudinal data comparison of PROEM activity in the Anglophone world. ABS published its most recent analysis for those who work paid and unpaid in the culture and leisure industries in 2007. In the context of their report, work included that undertaken for free or with very little payment, but not pastimes undertaken purely for the individual's own enjoyment or for that of their family and friends. Those people were defined as hobbyists and excluded from the data sets. Thus, unusually for such statistical analysis, ABS captured the PROAMs as well as the paid professionals. Furthermore, similar research undertaken by ABS in 1993, 1997, 2001 and 2004 allowed for trend analysis of the data. Sadly, no compatible data were published subsequent to 2007. And in 2014, the Bureau announced that it would no longer collect and analyse data relating to culture and sport due to funding cuts by the Commonwealth Government. The 2007 ABS data set showed a six-fold rise in the number of adult Australians actively involved in the visual arts since 1993. The visual arts were defined as including drawing, painting, sculpture, photography, and printmaking. By 2007, the total number of those actively involved in the visual arts had risen to some 1.85 million people. When the creation of artworks using a computer and sundry other forms of visual art were added, the figure rose to 2.5 million. The number of adult Australians involved in craft making had risen 4.5-fold in the same period, accounting for another 900,000 active makers. Once sundry craft activities not measured in earlier data sets were added, the total number of people in Australia involved in the visual arts and crafts at pro-am or professional level amounted to 3.6 million, or about 23% of the adult population. The great majority of these were pro-ams. During the 12 months prior to interview, 81% of the visual arts practitioners and 84% of the craft practitioners worked without generating any income, which is not to say that they did not derive personal value from what they did, simply that they did not receive money for it. If one extends the pro-am range to include income of no more than $5,000 Australian dollars per year, then the figure rises to 90% for visual arts and 94% for craft. Again, to reiterate, this excludes hobbyists. Set in the context of a creative industry's ethos where monetization is the fundamental driver, this seems inexplicable. Why should so many people want to spend so much time developing skills that could not bring them financial reward? And in the longer arc of the Arts Council ethos, why were so many individuals who ought to be audiences working so hard to become practitioners? The point is that this is not a zero-sum equation. And it's not that the audience for art is strictly limited, such that a small group of those sanctioned as artists can produce all that is required. Of course, if you think of art as simply a luxury commodity in the marketplace for the uber rich, there may be some reality to that view, especially if you ensure that the majority feel excluded. But if you see art as an activity that engages many, potentially all members of the community, with some being virtuosi and many having something more modest but nonetheless valuable to offer, then the more activity there is, the greater the demand. The preference for active engagement reflected in the ABS statistics is hardly surprising. As Francoise Matarazzo has pointed out, it is in the act of creation that empowerment lies. In my view, a public institution should have at its heart a concern for the creative expression of the many, not the few. For as Matarazzo goes on to say, it is through sharing creativity that understanding and social inclusiveness are promoted. It is an assessment shared by the Australian psychologist and social researcher Hugh Mackey, who is of the opinion that in deciding which artists and organisations should receive government funding, there's a danger to overlook a crucial point. I quote, "The greatest public value of the arts is through participation in them, rather than merely being exposed to them as spectators. The most intense benefits of the arts flow from creating and performing, so why aren't we using public money to extend those benefits more widely?" This raises a broader question of public value. Active engagement in the arts might be good for the individual and their experience of the world, but why, as Mackey asserts, is it of public value? Are the benefits of such an approach to be found beyond the simple pleasures of personal expression and the engendering of individual well-being? I think the answer is a resounding yes. Active engagement in the arts by citizens participating in the creation of their culture delivers public good for the community as a whole and for wider society. This is because a more democratic approach to art actually results in a net gain in what one might, for want of a better word, call the achievement of excellence. That might sound counterintuitive. We've become accustomed to thinking that the best way to achieve excellence is through meritocracy, the promotion of and investment in those who are the best in a given area. In such a system, responsibility for the creation and delivery of one or another aspects of society's needs is placed in the hands of a small number of specialists, frequently to the exclusion of all others. The majority of the less than expert are considered of little value to the processes and pursuit of excellence, but simply relegated to the role of passive beneficiaries of the work of those few who are elevated to the status of expert. The rest become consumers. However, as the Canadian writer John Ralston Saul has argued with very considerable clarity, a meritocratic system in seeking to avoid the, quote, inefficiencies imagined to be inherent in the processes of democracy is in reality wasteful of human talent and weak in terms of delivering benefits to society as a whole. He explains it thus: the disordered, messy, inefficient world of democracy can release a surprising percentage of society's genius. A meritocracy, on the other hand, is so busy concentrating on efficiently identifying who is best and pushing him to the fore that it shuts down its confidence in the rest of us, those of us who are willing to contribute, each in her own way and at her own level. The whole idea of a society of winners, a place known above all for its best, leads with surprising speed to a narrow pyramidal social structure and then to division and widespread passivity. That, in turn, leads to false populism and mediocrity, to a world obsessed with bread and circuses, heroes, and the need for leadership. I should just note here that his alternating use of the male and female pronoun is a convention adopted to avoid sexist language and not a specific attribution to any particular qualities of one gender or another. Saul is making a general observation, but I think it has a particularly acute point to consider in the field of the arts, where an obsession with excellence has had the debilitating impact on the culture of the community and on the human value of the arts. As they say in Japan, none of us is smarter than all of us. This is not to argue narrowly that one must first sing in order to appreciate choral music or paint before one can enjoy visual art. Rather, it is to suggest that becoming active in an area of the arts places the individual in a different relationship to the culture of the community as a whole, one of being a co-producer and not simply a consumer. It's important to avoid the supposition that an audience with little knowledge of art is a cognitively empty vessel that should be filled by a person of expertise through the transfer of knowledge. The Brazilian educationalist Paulo Freire described this approach through an analogy with banking, whereby those who consider themselves knowledgeable deposit information in the minds of those whom they consider to know nothing, as one might deposit money in an empty bank account. Freire argues that this sets up a dangerous oppositional relationship which oppresses the learner in order to maintain the inequalities of the status quo by denying the learner's ability to intervene in the world and so become a transformer of that world. The capability of banking education to minimize or annul the student's creative power and to stimulate their credulity serves the interests of the oppressors who care neither to have the world revealed nor to see it transformed. It is important to note here that it's not simply about reducing personal creativity, but about propagating uncritical credulity. To accept the status quo and not to ask questions or seek explanations, let alone seek to change things for the better. While I'm using educational theory to describe this process, I'd not want to suggest that such active participation is simply didactic. Rather, I'm drawing on theories of learning which take a much broader view of how experience is transformed into insight, and then employing those expanded understandings to illuminate one aspect of the more complex question of art as experience, an experience which both extends and deepens our sense of ourselves, the world, and ourselves in the world. We come to understand not simply that an object or action has been made special, but that the human intervention by which symbolic value was so created. And in this lies the possibility of empathy, of a deep somatic connection realized through action. This is why Mackie's observation is important. It's not simply about finding less academic ways by which audiences might come to the arts, but that those active and participatory approaches hold the possibility of a quite different, richer, and more deeply integrated experience and interconnection, experiences of interconnection and agency. Ones which, as Saul points out, not only benefit the individual, but also help to avoid the threats of mediocrity and false populism in the wider community, something that's acutely we should be aware of today. And this has another very practical importance for all those who care about the arts. A citizenry actively participating and personally invested in the arts will ensure that the arts stand high in the community and in the minds of those for whom they vote. Successful politicians, whatever else they may be, understand the things people value and for which they will vote or withhold their support. The arts will never be a politically viable issue as long as they are presented as the artifacts of the rich and the playthings of an elite, which the wider community may only enjoy if first they agree to absorb the views of that elite and dismiss their own effective and intellectual judgments. An over-professionalisation of the arts in the 20th century has brought its own downside. It has seen a steady erosion of support for the arts by the many, who have been told in no uncertain terms by the elite that the elite know best, and that if they don't get it, it's simply their lack of intelligence and sensitivity, which the elite believes it has and jealously protects. There's a phrase I often hear used, I've heard it today, in defense of such exclusive and excluding behavior, that we must not dumb down the arts. What always surprises me about that phrase is just how much it indicts the user. It takes the Americanization of the word dumb, which conflates and strategically confuses the idea that if someone is unable to speak, they are idiots with nothing to say, and applies it to a situation where those excluded from our cultural discourses are labeled stupid, when in reality, they have simply not been permitted a voice. In our meritocratic system, we have come to believe that the only serious artist is full-time, making a living from their art, which means selling into the art market or surviving on funding from one or another government bureaucracy, commercial sponsor, or private patron. But the pro-am, who relies on none of these, is not a new kind of artist. For example, to take at random a few artists from history who earned their living in other fields while making their work. Geoffrey Chaucer was a bureaucrat and diplomat. Robert Burns was a farmer and exciseman. Anthony Trollope was a postal surveyor, and in fact, he introduced the United Kingdom's first freestanding pillarboxes. Charles Dodgson, who we know better as Lewis Carroll, was a mathematician and cleric. Bram Stoker was a civil servant turned theatre manager. T.S. Eliot was a banker and editor. Alexander Borodin was a professor of chemistry. In fact, he was a professorial chair in chemistry at the Imperial Medical Surgical Academy in St. Petersburg. The composer Charles Ives was an insurance salesman, executive. The poet William Carlos Williams was a paediatrician. Mark Rothko worked as a primary school teacher and later an art school teacher until he was nearly 50. The poet Norman McCaig was a teacher all his working life. Philip Glass worked as a plumber and taxi driver until he was well into his 40s. A full and fertile culture needs the involvement not just of professionals, but pro-ams and indeed amateurs. The soloists need the choir just as much as the choir needs the soloists. It's not just that we have more art or that we consequently have more demand, but that the understanding of art increases in a way that it does not simply through reading about art or being instructed by experts. There's an old Chinese proverb, "Tell me and I will forget. Show me and I may remember, but involve me and I will understand." Involve me and I will understand. In my research into alternative ways of conceiving of and supporting the arts as a shared participatory activity that involves the many and not the few, I've derived a way of thinking about the kind of context in which such a state of affairs might flourish. I've called this a conversive community. I've already defined what I mean by community, but what do I mean by conversive? This is not a word in common use today, but it helps to draw attention to the fact to another quality, the fact that it has two subtly different usages derived from slightly different etymologies. That plurality of meaning adds considerably to the value in the way I want to employ it. The first sense, derived from conversation, means ready to converse. Its second sense, derived from conversion, means capable of change. It's also closely related to the word conversant, suggesting familiarity born from being inside and among. Therefore, as I'm coining the phrase, a conversive community is one that's communicative, adaptive, and inclusive. Within such communities, the creation of art is not simply possible, but will, I believe, flourish. If, as Mark Ravenhill has argued, we need a plan B, if that plan is to recognize and harness the power inherent in a democratic society, if the arts are truly to enrich the lives of the people such that they become not just active participants but active advocates and voters for the arts, a good place to start is to remember this. Communities are borderless. They are built around a heart, and they are interconnected by people. People have agency when they relate to and act with others, when they work together to shape the world in which they live, rather than in isolation, making individual retail decisions, of which the decision of how to spend one's time and in which particular art form to consume is but one aspect. The more we are actively involved in the arts, the more our lives are enriched, and we, in turn, help to enrich the lives of others. The arts provide a potent field for active imagining. They are how we speak to ourselves, of ourselves. We do damage not only to the arts, but to our communities and to the citizens that constitute them, if we say that only some may speak within our artistic culture, while the mass of others may only listen and look. Involving more people in the arts won't stifle innovation. It will help it blossom. Let me leave you with this thought. Lord Kelvin was one of the 19th century's great physicists. An inventor of note, he was knighted by Queen Victoria for his scientific discoveries. Lord Kelvin was adamant that it was impossible to create a heavier-than-air flying machine. It took two amateur bicycle mechanics, Orville and Wilbur Wright, to prove him wrong. And look where that got us. Thank you. I'm not sure how we're doing for time. I'm very happy to answer questions or enter a conversation with you if there is time.
Thanks very much, Alasdair. It's a really interesting thesis. And I enjoyed the argument very much. However, I think that there are a couple of other ways in which one might test through this that render the argument more complicated in general terms. And I'm not in the least bit dismissing the importance of making the argument in terms of the arts institutions. One is, what happens if you run the whole argument through in terms of women's creativity? If we look at was it 12 portraits of white men that we saw? Actually, you'd be hard put until recent years to find women who didn't make their living or work in some other capacity. For example, you know the capacities. And the second point is in relation to photography, actually, because photography has a very ambiguous and complex relationship with art, from which it was largely excluded as a notion until second half of the 20th century, sort of at best historically. Fox Talbot and his collaborators variously sort of fit in the pro-am definition anyway. I completely understand that the context is different, but I'm sort of wondering how it works if we remove from, you know, if we run the argument through in relation to, first of all, a different thread through the arts, the creativity, I guess, is a sort of creative engagements and seeing and visual literacy, and also in relation to specifically gender was the one that struck me, but there are other ways of thinking about that. I don't doubt you've been asked this question quite often, but I think it would be nice to hear, you know, where you think some of the ambiguities lie.
Okay, where I'm standing, I get a lot of bass and very little treble, so I heard some of what you said, but I think there are two questions there. The second one is about photography and its in-out relationship with the art world and where that sits. And the first one was to do with how can complexity arise if it's such a populist activity? Is that roughly it?
It's
of women's creativity. Yeah, well, let me put it in a slightly different way. One of the more controversial statements that I often make is that art history is a lie. Art history is not the history of art. It is the history of aristocratic and religious art. And the reason that we look at it is because it was made in materials that could be kept by people who had stable enough domestic or institutional arrangements for it to be kept. What shaped us as societies as we grew was what was made by individual people, often women. I mean, the other thing is that somewhere as the arts became defined, men decided that those art forms that women were involved in were not arts, they were best crafts and sort of domestic, and the things that men did were serious art forms. So there's a number of different layers. But I think it's really important to understand that what has shaped us as a developing society over millennia, right from caves up onwards, has not been what's happening in aristocratic circles, because that was only really known by a courtier class, but actually by what was happening among people. And I think there's been an accident that photography fitted the art world for a while, and I think it's coming to an end, and I think it's a good thing. I think we're about to enter the third age of photography. The first age, the focus of photography was bringing distant things close. But with the First World War, the world changed in the West particularly radically. And what people realized looking at photographs was that actually the world wasn't like that anymore. And increasingly in the 20th century, we began to think of the photograph as being archival. And indeed, even at theoretical level with people like Barthes and Susan Sontag, that the photograph was always related to death. The idea of an archival object is one that persists, and the art market loves objects that persist. And so it was possible to, with a certain amount of prostituting of the medium, to inveigle it into the art world by pretending it was a printmaking process where you had to limit editions when you don't, particularly now, in order to appear like art forms. Now, I'm quite sure that that aspect will continue. It's rather like the Reformation. The Reformation, with printing press, which then brought on the Reformation, didn't overthrow the Catholic Church, but it did diversify religion. It diversified who could speak, and it led to many things that the people who initiated the Reformation certainly didn't expect, to do with the Scientific Revolution and so on. The fact is, in terms of practice, photography is moving away from the archive and towards images which are made in an instant and circulated without the intention of keeping them, but with the intention of broadly circulating them. In other words, it's moving from the idea of archive to the idea of conversation. And I think there's a really important role for photography there, one which can possibly lead the arts away from the obsession of contemporary art world with monetizable artifacts, back to and into the idea of a culture as a living way in which together we imagine the future. Because as we can see in the world today, what's happening is a direct result of the fact that people don't think for themselves, but are quite happy to take on board what they're told from above. A community that actually thought about what was best for it would never have done, for instance, what's happening in America. Those states which are the net beneficiaries of taxation, which will be cut under current administration, are the very ones that that voted in the Republicans and their leader. So I think we should not see culture as something that either has to slavishly follow a market or that needs to be relegated to art galleries, but actually something that is about a living conversation. And I do believe that photography, if we can embrace where it's going in terms of popular terms and not have that dreadful reactionary thing, it's not like it was when I was young, everything's going to the dogs, we'd realize that actually we could be leading the cultural conversation today. I don't know if I've covered both your points, but yeah.
So we will have to call it to a halt there, otherwise we'll have trouble catching up. Alasdair, thank you very much for that fascinating piece. Yeah?
Thank you. I'm around, so feel free to, as you used to say.
Thank you. হলেন আগে প্লাগ অফ করেন